Hello and welcome back to LCS Lockie, and my name is Julian Pastry-Tamkar, joined by the color caster who can't help but keep it real. It's Sam Kobe Hartman-Kensler as we're gearing up for CLG versus TSM, two storied teams that are in search of their new identities.
Super excited for this one, Pastry-Tam. TSM and CLG have so much history, and they're actually coming into this tournament with fairly similar bumpy starts. I mean, a lot of failures in the early games for both of them. They started with losses, and yet, yesterday, both teams found wins. TSM over Golden Guardians, as well as the win for CLG. And honestly, it's going to be a long path for these teams, because both of them have a lot to build on. They've had visa issues on the side of CLG, TSM bringing together multiple members and a new shot caller for themselves. So it's going to be a lot of building on both sides.
Yeah, I mean, there are almost no remaining players from 2020 on either of these teams. Speaker being the only one on the TSM side, and CLG holding on to only Pobelta and Smoothie. And in general, almost every team has a loss, and at least every team has a win. So Lock-In has been pretty wild so far as results go, and potentially expecting that here as well. Although I think these two teams, from what we've seen in their wins, do want to play at a pretty similar pace, if nothing else. So I'm curious to see if either team wants to mix it up, or if we are in for potentially a longer game. Because I think if you had to bet, might be here for a while between these two.
Yeah, and honestly, people still to this day refer to the TSM versus CLG rivalry, but that was a long time ago. And with TSM dominating CLG for so long, Reginald recently has even straight up come out and said, like, the rivalry is dead. He doesn't want to be associated with CLG at all. He said it's a dead brand. Like, he does not want to touch CLG with a 10-foot pole at this point. So I think that actually adds more fuel onto this fire for TSM CLG games. Even if he doesn't want a rivalry, them is fighting words. So we'll see what they can actually pull out here, as both teams want to build on that momentum we talked about for yesterday, having those comeback wins to try and build throughout the Lock-In tournament and peak towards spring split starting. Let's take a look here. A lot of map control banned out here for TSM. Twisted Fate into Leah is one of my favorite combos right now, because it does provide so much, so many options for your team trying to play top or bottom side. Talia works so great with those point and click stuns, and then you snowball it with your global map pressure.
Also, Gnar banned away, a champion that's been a bit contentious, but has been picked a number of times already in the LCS Lock-In. And then Orianna and Pantheon joining alongside the CLG side, with one more ban to go before TSM grab first pick. So, starting to see the meta, like, solidify. I think a lot of what we saw leading up to this tournament around the world has been pretty similar. But Victor, definitely a pick that is more specific to this particular matchup. Both Power of Evil and Pobelta already with plays on that champion.
Yeah, Orianna and Victor banned away here on the side of CLG, really targeting Power of Evil. I mean, these are the two champions that he's played, and some of the ones that he's most known for. And honestly, with the TSM comps that we've seen so far, the strategy that they have come in to this tournament with, it hasn't been anything surprising or spectacular. They've been fairly straightforward team fighting compositions, and oftentimes they even sacrificed a lot of early game laning. They had bad matchups in multiple lanes in some of their drafts. So they're starting it out much stronger here. Olaf, king of the jungle right now, very, very powerful. People have been talking about the healing and the gore drinker. But honestly, too, the clear speed and the ability to go for even level one invades with the threat of the repeatable slow of your axe does set you up for trying to have some game plans laid straight out of champ select.
All right, well, Kai'Sa and Syndra are the answers there for CLG. So we'll see if Power of Evil does want to go to the Akali. He's going to flash it for a second, but it'll be Azir instead. So keeping the control mages, you know, keeping in the wheelhouse here for Power of Evil.
I actually am so surprised. Akali goes through a pick and ban phase here. No bans is pretty rare, but also then not getting picked. Both of these teams kind of just saying, yes, we do want to play team fights front to back. We don't want to have to work around a melee style carry, no matter how many dashes she has, no matter how much mobility, and no matter how effective she is shown to be. Akali does not get to play. But, you know, Faker picking a bunch of Azir back back-to-back bunch of games. So Power of Evil says, that's good enough for me. He picks up the answer. And honestly, I've been a pretty big fan of Jhin lately. It's the combination of the crowd control that you bring from bottom side from an AD carry role, which is, you know, fairly rare, but also the burst that you can actually have. And looking at the opponent lineup, of course, there's no tanks already, so looks like he could be set up for success.
Yep, I'm actually surprised we haven't seen as much Jhin as maybe I thought, but Kai'Sa certainly has been like the AD carry to pick, and of course that was picked by CLG, so it is nice to see Lost pick up Jhin here. We'll see how he can function alongside new lane partner Sword Art. Again, TSM, five players that have never played together before, trying to figure everything out. Certainly some growing pains as expected, but this is partly what the lock-in tournament is for. Thresh though, banned away from Sword Art. I like that. I've seen a lot of very high impact supports between Rell, Leona, and the likes of Thresh. It is nice to take a couple of those playmakers away from Sold Out.
Honestly, there's so many playmaking supports right now too. Both teams are going to have to use all their bans if they really want to win down on this pool. Because as you mentioned, you know, even Rell, the new champion, some of the support players not quite up to speed on it, but the ones that have shown to be up to speed have had really good combinations. And you can have these dream scenarios where you're able to jump in, you get your knockup, you get your stun with the back through, and your ultimate, basically a gravity well, pulling multiple people in for stuff like, you know, Syndra stuns to line through. And it's just those layers upon layers of crowd control that have shown success and a lot of the team fight focus that we have had.
Yeah, we'll see what happens here because it's three supports banned already, Thresh, Set, and Lulu. The three bans here, TSM going to respond. Might take Darrell away, yeah. Don't want to give that one back to Smoothie after the game he had yesterday.
Honestly, okay, CLG, I still want to see playmaking support for Smoothie, especially because they have Graves locked in for the jungle. And you're going to need somebody who can roam early on around the map to try and help out with that. And if you do have Renekton on top side, that is going to be just throwing down a gauntlet of a blind pick that is very difficult to deal with. You don't really have counter picks that you can come up with. And leaving Smoothie's support for final counter here for CLG, I would definitely still expect it to be something, you know, along the lines of the Alistar, along the lines of that Leona, to try and actually make those plays with Griffin.
Yeah, both those champions available as well. So there's Ornn going to be for Huni, most likely there in the top side. And then we have probably the pick of the two supports you mentioned here for Sword Art. He can take whichever one he wants. Although also Maokai, which we've seen today, potentially a possibility, also can start engages. Great with Imperial Mandate, as we saw in just our last game. But I feel like Alistar might be the pick here. It's been very popular leading into the LCS lock-in all around the world. But plenty of options here. Sword Art, not one to shy away from any sort of playmaking.
And seeing him play Alistar the other day as well, it brings me back to Flash Wolves days. You know, seeing Sword Art on the world stage, we would see him. It was like clockwork. Every time we'd go to an international event, oh, look who the representative is. Guess what? It's Flash Wolves, and Sword Art is on some sort of playmaking support, trying to roam through your jungle, come up with these crazy flanks. He doesn't end up locking it in favor of that Maokai Imperial Mandate. Big brush control for the bottom side, but also big harassment that can come through later, and another source of significant AP threat. That being said, giving up the Alistar there with his Maokai pick, surprise, surprise, it is locked in. That's what we were looking for Smoothie. So honestly, I do like the answers here from both sides, and there are no surprises. Both of them coming in with some team fighting focus, a little bit more early game oriented for CLG. With your Renekton into Ornn, you're going to want to try and take advantage of the top side of the map in the early stages. We'll see if Solo can come in and do that. He prides himself on being a jack of all trades. We've seen him, you know, play weak side a lot. Now it's time to play some strong side and show him what you got.
Yep, and again, we'll see how Griffin goes, of course, formerly Wiggly, if that name is somehow looking at you very confusedly, but he actually played pretty well on Lotilia in their win yesterday. So now on Graves, which has not been the most successful pick so far in lock-in, but certainly a very powerful jungler, especially if you get ahead.
Yeah, and honestly, I know that it's been like kind of controversial, but I think that Graves is an extremely well-rounded and strong jungler right now. It's maybe if you lose some other things in draft phase in order to over-prioritize it, that's where we've been seeing some failures. But let's get right into it. TSM versus CLG. If nothing else, you get to talk a lot of trash afterwards. That is for sure.
That's true. The social stakes are very high in this match, even though, again, it is going to be a long year for both of these teams, for all our teams, really, which is part of the fun of the LCS lock-in in the first place. But 2021 started Kobe and TSM vs. CLG are going to almost take us out of week one of the LCS here, as Power of Evil and Pobelta are going to do battle, of course, with Azir and Syndra.
And so even though we've also, you know, especially on the international stage in LCK and a couple of the LPL games, seen Olaf's just take over versus Graves games, I still like the Graves side of these matchups, especially with Phase Rush. You have so much mobility, but it does depend a lot on your lanes. And since he's the one with the Renekton super strong side, top side, I actually like the position here for the Graves, for Griffin, to try and cut off the Olaf's income early on, try and really abuse it. And they're doing that right off the bat. Level one invade on the red. Sword Art is down there. And they're actually calling down Spica, but he's going to get there very late. I think CLG might be able to get it and smite it away before he even arrives.
Yeah, I mean, they are going to get the buff, but can they get out? The sapling from Sword Art actually did a pretty good amount of damage to Smoothie, but at the end of the day, they are just going to walk out here. Even Huni actually walking down in case something was going to happen. So Griffin also going to go ahead and take some of those wraps away. I don't know if he got the big one, but based on the 5-2 scoreline currently for jungle minions taken, I'm going to guess he probably did.
He did smite, so I'm assuming that that Spica was able to at least get that one since Griffin used his smite on the red. Regardless, this is what I'm talking about. Graves versus Olaf, starting out with an invade. This allows the Graves to really abuse that range advantage. With Phase Rush, you are not nearly as scared as almost all other champions are of the Olaf in the early game. You can quick draw to dodge the axes, and what you want to do is dodge perpendicular to where he's throwing them at you, so that then the Olaf has to walk the long distance to go pick it up. He's nothing without his cooldown reset on the axes in the early game. And with the Phase Rush, Graves then gets to follow up. So this should be really, really good an opener here for Griffin, for CLG. So I want to see what he can do with it. I like how he's pathing up towards the top side. We talked about the strong Renekton matchup into the Ornn, going to give him full priority over there. And we'll see if he can actually work on getting the double crab. Because honestly, bottom side pushing in for a TSM means Spica should be running straight over there to make sure the double crab does not happen.
Yeah, Griffin actually taking a little bit of a detour here to ensure the three buff, which he does complete, but of course going to move over to this topside crab. And Speaker probably already assumed that this one was going to die and didn't want to face the Graves of double buffs, so just going to go ahead and take this bottom crab here and at least get some of this money and some of this vision as well in the early game. So doesn't get double crab, thankfully, but Griffin's still going to stay ahead here early on in this jungle matchup.
Yeah, it's still going to be a ginormous lead here for Griffin, for formerly known as Wiggly. And again, he's got a lot of CC to work with too. So this is an ideal scenario from the jungling perspective. You have possibilities of big plays on bottom, mid, and even top if Solo is able to whittle down this Ornn. Possibility of dives there. Pobelter showcasing some of the setup that Syndra does has. Nice stun there into the harassment onto PoE. So really, honestly, this is one of the games where you do have multiple good choices for the jungler, and it is going to come down to execution here for Griffin, for Wiggly.
Of note, both mid laners actually already used their TP, so quite a lot of trading back and forth. Pobelter especially was getting the lane pushed in up against PoE. In the bottom side, kind of an interesting matchup developing, but Lost and Sold Out actually very far ahead in the 2v2 currently. There's, what, 7 minions there about to hit the tower, but behind more than that for Turtle, currently down 12 as that minion crashes in. So Kai's have been pretty tricky to kick out of lane and just in general get out of game because she's so powerful. It feels like at most stages of the game, but so far so good, despite having exhaust over something like Ignite, which Smoothie has. You'd think the threat might be there a bit more for the CLG 2v2.
Mm-hmm. And bottom side too, I kind of like these Maokai matchups because it's so different from a lot of other supports where, like, your sapling spam basically guarantees you the brush control, and so then the other team starts to end up playing a lot more for river access and for trying to threaten river ganks from their jungler, because Smoothie on that Alistar very well could still go for the all-in, go for the combo. You mentioned Ignite for Smoothie. That can be the difference in going for that burst kill versus the exhaust for Sword Art, which is a lot better for the all-in dives that come a lot later. Very good at shutting down the Kai'Sa once she gets to the Killer Instinct. But yeah, here it is. Still topside control here for Solo as expected. And Griffin comes to capitalize. This is what you want to do when you have that early winning area. And this has been one of the things for both these teams in the early game. They have struggled throughout the tournament thus far.
All right, well, Solo actually up massively in that lane. 25 CS currently, although Huni does have TP. Probably going to commit it here. As I thought, the teams might be poking a bit further into the Drake pit, but no team is going to start the objective just yet. So, Kobe, I have a question for you. How many here. Tier of the Goddesses have you yeah. seen on Ornn?
I was like, I know exactly where you're going because Hootie's stacking up the tier here. I'm very excited to see where this one goes because I have not seen too many of them. So we'll definitely keep track of it for him. Let me tell you one thing, Pastry. Tier does not help you if they decide to go for the dive. And Huni does take a little detour here to blow up the blast cone, but he's got a nice forward-facing defensive ward here to see into the river to make sure they can track Griffin. Graves up to level 6 already. That lead in the jungle still holds true. But honestly, Infernal Drake should be the site of jungle focus now moving forward, and that is going to change things looking at how well Lost and Sword Art have done here in the early stages.
All right, well, just to confirm for everyone, I know we changed a lot of items in the offseason, but our tier still only builds into the two items you remember. So I'm guessing it's just for actually mana in the lane here to maybe help Huni through what does look to be quite a rough early laning phase, down about 30 CS right now. Power of Evil, though, about to meet a surprise. No, it's Speaker, actually. My eyes deceive me. As just covering POEs, he's getting this lane shoved in. Looks like that early harass that Pobelta had hasn't really perturbed him too much here. As Huni's actually looking to roam here. I like this roam. I believe might have been spotted there, but at least, you know, doing something, trying to affect another lane, because you know that 1v1, you're just waiting for Solo to kind of bounce the way back towards your tower. As a result, though, TSM are going to move in and take down the first Drake. They grab the Infernal at just under 7:30.
Good news here, again, of that bottom side for themselves. Lost and Sword Art been pushing in over and over. Nice little window for them to work with, despite Griffin still being a little bit ahead on those camps. But Beltair does end up getting the blue there for Syndra. And honestly, it should be a Rift Herald for CLG to try and push ahead on the early advantage that they have, because they give up this bottom side, they give up this Infernal Dragon, but they still have Solo crashing wave after wave into the Tier of the Goddess start here for Huni.
All right, well, blue going to go over to PoE as well. Speaker here making sure to get the donation happening. But that one's handed off nice and easy. A Speaker now level 6 alongside that Graves. Going to get that Rift Herald watered up, make sure nothing can happen in the area. And as you said, as we pan down to the bottom lane, it is the same story. Lost and Sword Art just continuing to get the shove happening. Sword Art actually going for a base. Might be seeing a little swapsy towards the top side for that Herald, but we'll see what TSM's next move is.
Yeah, I mean, it should be just continue clearing here and try to keep up defensive vision towards the Rift Herald. You can see they've already gotten the early ward on it, so they're expecting the move from CLG as well to try and push the game state forward. And Sword Art now can roam. He's got a timer right here. He's gone back for Sork Shoes, rushing to those tier 2s, which makes the saplings here actually devastating. Gives you the vision as well as a nice little chunk onto the jungler. Every one of those does kind of stack up here. They're actually having pings onto the bottom side, so TSM making the call. Yes, we know. You've got this ginormous Renekton advantage on top side. They're not going to fight it. Congratulations. They don't fight a losing objective here, Pastry. This is the better decision. They go to the other side of the map to try and trade something for themselves, try and punish here on the bottom side. Let's see if Turtle has to blow summoners, as they've got a little trap waiting. That ward gives it away, though.
Yeah, he has to know now as Sword Art emerges from the shrubbery. But probably had something to do with that call to trade as well. So I'm just going to pressure this tower as expected. Smoothie, though, rejoining Turtle means that he's probably pretty safe. Sword Art going to say absolutely not. Flash, Twisted Advance. There goes Speaker in, but can't quite find it as Turtle does flow. Actually, not flash out. He's back in. That's a Turtle classic there, but could be a problem there as the ulti is going to catch him over the wall. Goes Speaker, and that's first blood for the Olaf.
Oh, Turtle saw it. He saw it in his eyes. Ah, I'm going to get that $5 million kill onto Sword Art. Oh, doesn't quite have it. The heal comes in. Sword Art walks away unscathed. Exhaust goes down. That's what we're talking about. This exhaust is so good at shutting down the killer instinct. Surprise, surprise. Even flashing out afterwards. There's the follow from Spica, and TSM successfully do trade on the other half of the map when they know they have to forfeit top side. Good use by CLG setting that up, you know, good call to power through with the Rift Herald like we were looking for. Yet that was definitely a costly mistake on the bottom side. Let's take another look at it. As we were talking about, you know, the changes in the summer spells on bottom side. Whether Sword Art knows he's baiting as he goes in for this or not, you have to wait for the explanation on the outside, but Lost is there with the heal, so Turtle gets baited in, and Spica can just chase him down, flash following, turning that into not just zoning CLG's bottom side off of experience, as it would have been for a couple of waves while the top side play takes place. But that also gives, you know, a bunch of extra kill over. That gives Spica a much-needed kind of boost in catching up due to the early invade that CLG got off and Griffin getting that lead. So very, very nice stuff for TSM in answer to the power play from CLG.
Yeah, it's also given Lost early Gale Force here as well. He's up almost 1,000 gold on Turtle. So Turtle can't really do much in any sort of direct 2v2 challenge. Just going to have to sit back and wait here because the all-in potential is very real.
Yeah, and you know what? Hey, now next time he won't be surprised by the exhaust. He's like, oh yeah, you know what? Could have learned that by checking tab, but does learn it by using R and diving straight on in. See if it ends up mattering though over Dragon Fight number 2. 30 seconds left on this one, and Huni does have teleport and Ornn ultimate available, so there is the possibility of it actually breaking out into the 5-on-5 instead of just seeding it over this time. Because CLG don't have to expend any extra resources towards the top side of the map right now. I would very much doubt that they would want to give away Dragon number 2 for free over to the hands of TSM.
You're going to have to be careful. Both top laners do have TP. In fact, all 4 teleports currently up. A solo looking to get some harassment happening under the tower. He's got Claude Drinker finished. So Mythic done there for the CLG top laner. Same there for Griffin with his own Gale Force. And then Claude Drinker on the other side there for Speaker's TSM will indeed start this dragon. The CLG are going to be moving down to contest. Solo is actually almost in the area just from using them legs alone.
Guess they are just going to give it right on over. Maokai ult comes out for the zoning just to make sure nobody from CLG is coming over, but they were not making any sort of move towards it. Guess the difference here with Gale Force on Jhin complete already, and Wild Turtle still struggling to put together his pieces since he did the super common Kai'Sa stopover. Basically, this serrated Dirk is a nice little boost of power. I mean, I really do value lethality for AD carries, but it does delay your big, big power spike of completing your mythic item, most notably Gale Force for that big execution possibility.
All right, well, Smoothie threatening a dive here. He's going to be spotted by the sapling, so Sword Art doing a pretty good job playing goalie down here in the bottom half of the map. Lost does stay safe as he farms out under the tower. PoE also is just moving himself down towards that side of the map in case more commitment from CLG happen. In fact, Turtle really wants to get this counter kill here. Smoothie could just go for the dive, but no flash going to make it awfully hard, despite having the ignite ready and the ultimate up. Hex flash, not real good in those situations where you need to instantly close a gap. Much better if you're setting something up over a wall.
Definitely true. The big chunk of damage, too, and blowing that Gale Force cooldown does mean for CLG that they could keep up pressure, threatening possible dives onto Lost, though. So you can see they're calling down Wiggly already. I like this call. Keep the pressure up on the cooldowns that you've blown already. Even though this isn't the nerfed Gale Force, cooldown still 50% left, and he is!
Oh, that's a flash, but it's not enough. Smoothie gonna catch him in Turtle. Gonna find the snipe. TP's coming in for both here as Solo, and actually two members of TSM have made their way in to the fray. Ulti is gonna hit onto POB. See you later, Syndra, as Power of Evil collects that kill.
And it's all teleports channeled back onto bottom side of the map, even though CLG, it looked like the initial dives just so clean. Boom, Lost is so dead there, and they try and get out because the teleports were committed. Pobelter finds himself very deep here and actually ends up giving one over back to the side of TSM. in kind of payment. So definitely they, upon you know, revision, they would have loved to not have to commit so many things. But look at the minimap. Everybody coming down. CLG pick up the kill so quickly, though, and everybody's starting to escape. That Pope Belter here just gets caught off as, you know, the collapse from TSM does find him. And all these ultimates being used, he does not get to move, saves his flash, knowing that he is going to die.
Yeah, didn't catch the exact order, but it looked like POB got thrown into on ulti by Azir ulti, which is a pretty bad way to go regardless. TSM just committing everything for the one kill, not trying to chase onto maybe Smoothie and get a bit greedy. So I like TSM just take the clean trade there, not getting too fancy with themselves as teams are assembling once again around the Rift Herald here. Neither top laner having TP, though, as Huni is still trying to fight back against Solo. Does have them plated steel caps going, but not sure that's enough to keep the Renekton at bay, especially given that Solo is also up a level currently. But yeah, you see both teams are assembling because nobody wants to give away this Herald for free either.
I'm waiting for the surprise at the end of this the story of the Tear of the Goddess Ornn here from Huni as well, because he's still stacking it right up there.
Yeah,
regardless, CLG, the good rotation up to the top side, especially with you know, Huni not having teleport, them showing is committing there for TSM, so everybody knows. This is overwhelming odds here for CLG. No opportunity for Ornn to arrive or anything like that. It is a conscious decision to trade bottom tower, bottom gold, to try and fund their war efforts instead.
Yeah, very similar actually to the last Rift Herald we had, where TSM just decided to take the trade on the bottom half of the map. This time it does give Huni level 11, so rank 2 ulti, and does give TSM their first tower of this game as well. The assumption is that the Rift Herald is once again going to get a tower here, likely the mid one if they can get it, but bot's also extremely weak if they just want to take the more fragile objective at this point. But 50 seconds till that dragon is up. We're starting to get to the point where CLG, I mean, you said they needed to contest the last one, Kobe, and I agree with you, but I think at this point you absolutely have to contest this third one.
Yeah, they're definitely going to be feeling the pressure if they don't. A lot of the vision for them has been expended on top side too with that latest, with that last push, so they need that reset. They've got 3 control wards in inventory, trying to move those over. There's only 26 seconds left on the arrival of the Ocean Dragon, so they have kind of this distraction Rift Herald mid first. Push the wave in, shove the Rift Herald in, try and get your damage. Oh, here we go.
Turtle already taking a lot of damage. That's a good ulti knocking up 2, I believe, from Huni, and that's a better follow-up there. The Jhin ulti also trying to get the damage done, but the snipes are trying to happen onto the carries here. Smoothie is the easier target, but he pops the ulti to stay alive. Still, TSM, enough space to get themselves Dragon number 3.
Yep, that is a one-team fight, Pastry. No kills, no problem. Plenty
that
of long range.
That's what success looks like.
Exactly. There's no blood on your hands. You don't have to get dirty there. Just send them packing with a bunch of the ults. Nice open there from Lost. Does find a good amount of the damage with the Jhin ult following up on it as well. So easy setup for the Ocean Soul for TSM, despite still being down in gold, despite not having the stronger side lane presence with the Renekton constantly pushing in. TSM have retained control of all dragons for this early game. And this is a discussion that we had so many times, Pastry, during Worlds about, oh, the interplay between some of these teams investing in early game matchups, investing in topside, Rift Herald. You get all this influx of gold early with your turret plates and with your Rift Herald activation, and then you have to use that to snowball your team with the rest of the map. But TSM, they did not fight those losing fights like we were talking about, where the Rift Herald, you know, you're outgunned on top side. So they take something on bottom side, and it's these little mistakes of a couple kills here and there. Turtle going in, a couple of the extra plates being taken, and here we go, CLG Smoothie.
Ooh, Smoothie's out of there, trying to reverse the play. We know cards are plenty, but Griffin over the wall is going to seal that one. His Power of Evil does fall down, but the counter kill is going to happen. Speaker with the easiest setup of his life as Huni's looking to make it 2 here. Now Griffin on the run. Does get knocked up by the Ornn. Empowered Auto was lost with the last bullet. Is going to make it happen. The grenade comes in for TSM to take the 2-for-1 trade.
And they could push straight up mid too. I mean, they're going to have another wave coming right down, and it's just Wild Turtle to try and wave clear for them. So TSM, actually, they have their sights set on Solo now. Let's see if they can make this collapse complete. Doesn't look like it. And honestly, you feel a little bad as a Renekton now, because Solo's been pushing his heart out. Look at the CS lead. I've been beating up this Ornn with Tear. You see this? And it's really not amounting to anything for the success of the team. team. Here's another look at the blue buff steal from Griffin. He does get it, but when they catch Smoothie on the inside here, PoE gets comboed and Griffin flashes over. However, Huni with the roam on this Ornn does make it in time for the long range Ornn ult to catch the counter kill. And then Griffin, having flashed over offensively to take down Power of Evil, has no escapes left. And in the end, it is actually TSM, despite CLG having a good opening to that fight, that comes away with the victory.
Yeah, and despite, you know, getting beaten up in lane, as we've been talking about for pretty much this whole early game through this 20 minutes of play, Huni's been really intelligent about how he's, you know, been playing weak side, not falling too far behind, accepting his death in some ways, right, in the 1v1. He just knows that help isn't coming.
And look how much mana he has!
he's ready. He's stacked it up to 360. Kobe, I'm going to be honest with you. I don't believe that he's going to make the into anything other than the stack tier it is now. But I'm willing to be wrong, as TP's coming in for solo and one more. Pobelta going to join the fray. But where do you go from here? Sword up with the ulti on the other side, actually trying to split the fight up. A speaker pop the Ragnarok. His turtle over the top is on the Power of Evil. See you later, Sunshine. As Griffin also going to take down Sword Art, that tree, no match for the Shotgun of Graves, as Baron is now the order of business for CLG.
Really, really big teleports here from Counter Logic Gaming. Can they make the play complete? Speaker's alive. He has flash on Olaf. He could go for the steal.
I mean, he's going to go for it here. Lost, actually going to get some damage down. Huni going to get the CC he needs to try and take down Smoothie. Lost finds the snipe. But our Speaker over the wall is going to be the troublesome one. Solo going to try and tie him up with the ulti out of Lost. Doing a lot of damage to Baron. He's going to go down. It's Griffin that's able to nab it. But CLG, how much more will they lose off the back end of this play? It is two kills down, but that is all. CLG do walk away with the Baron.
Ooh, nothing like a good old Baron with a possible 50-50 to get your heart pumping. Speaker does get the flash to the inside, but still picked up by Griffin. Nerves of steel for himself. Let's take a closer look at the replay at the slow, because this gets dicey. CLG have been feeling the pressure, and really good root combination here. Lost snares him up. Huni even goes in for a little combo there. Lost gets the finish on the kill and then opens up with his ultimate. Stun wears off on Speaker. He flashes in, 33 health. I saw 33 on that Baron before Griffin is able to get it. Holds on to the game for CLG. If that Baron goes over to TSM, the game comes crashing down, Pastry Time.
Yeah, I mean, tough spot as well, because Speaker's track record of stealing objectives has been pretty good recently. But CLG maintain the gold lead. It doesn't feel like they're ahead in gold. They are. They're up about 2,500 gold. They've got the Baron. They can maybe grow that lead, but they've got 10, 12 seconds to contest for this Drake. And I know we've said it about every Drake pretty much so far, but this one you really do need to make sure you don't give away. The Ocean Soul going to make this Ornn and Olaf and the Maokai and, you know, everyone probably too tough to contend with, as CLG are trying to close the trap here around TSM. But Huni's ready with the ulti. Jin W doesn't quite connect, but he does find two with the knockup. Also Sword Art ulti is charging in, and Soul are going to get cordoned off by the rest of TSM. Lost again with the ulti, finds a snipe on a Smoothie. Very nice bullet curvature there, as TSM will have a 5v4 around this Soul.
Yep, and again, TSM starting out with a big advantage.
Solo still, again, trying to find this flank, but Huni finds a knockup instead. He's going to force the flash away. Griffin here, but also needs to hold on to his own life. Is the only thing really preventing the Dragon from not getting absolutely obliterated. His turtle, despite being exhausted, does manage to pick up Renekton, but on the back end of, by Kai'Sa. It is Maokai. My brain realigned itself as the Drake is going to go over. We figured it out. It's TSM that do grab the Soul, because Griffin, I believe, is zoned out of play. There's Turtle going down. Pobelta is going to fall as well. Lost is going to pick up a double, as that's going to be the ace. Almost Smoothie respawning just in time to save that graphic from flashing up.
Yeah, TSM decided to make it easy for you, Pastry. They'll just kill everyone on CLG. Got them all. Got the Dragon in the end, too. Even though there was a bit of a ring around the rosy on the Dragon Pit here, they chase everyone down. Sword Art, the lone sacrifice for them to basically secure this one. Ocean Soul now picked up for TSM. CLG may have held the gold lead for most of the game, but the objective focus from TSM pays off. Huni gets the opening to scatter CLG up to the top side of the map. Look at the zoning that they do with these ultimates. This is actually insane. The Ornn long-range ult into the Maokai follow-up, zoning for Lost to be able to just poach them with the Jhin ulti, and they just chase down the stragglers afterwards, getting the kill. Solo goes down. Sword Art does get tagged with the slow and gets killed by Wild Turtle ulting in again. Exhaust not enough to save him this time around, but they've got the inside track for TSM on the dragon anyway. Spica has his smite. Griffin did not, so there was no hope for CLG. And then he's just going to die with the rest of the team for solidarity.
Yep, nice little play from PoE at the end of it all as well to get the Azir sec happening to pick up the kill on Turtle as my brain finally catches up with what I was watching earlier. TSM though going to check this brush. Griffin's in there. So is Smoothie, so is Pobelter, but TSM don't have to walk that way. They're going to assault the tier 2 with this Baron instead. Nice and simply PoE actually getting locked up by a nice long-range W out of Watch, who's looking real strong right now as three items. So Griffin charging in with the Gale Force, trying to make the big play happen. Almost takes Lost Life, but now Smoothie's going to get sniped once again. Two, three, one more. Almost.
Where's the go-go gadget extend on that bullet? Because that Jhin 4 bullet was headed straight for Griffin. No way to extend it, though. That is going to be turrets for TSM as they push on in. Now, there was an early Executioner's already on Solo, but they've also picked one up here on Griffin. So they're doing their best to try and deal with the situation that they're in versus the Ocean Soul. It's just that they're facing such a difficult scenario right now as TSM start to close in. Inhibitor turret number one down, and the pressure doesn't look like it's going to let up anytime soon.
Yep. Flukes to take this inhib as well. POV trying to throw out some stuns, but everyone's got ultis except for the bottom lane here of TSM, so not really afraid. CLG do not contest that inhib. It will fall, so 5 minutes of super minions flooding the top side of the map. Minute and 5 seconds till Baron as well. Also, 3:15 to the Elder Dragon is going to make an appearance pretty swiftly here in this game. And TSM now ahead in gold by a similar amount the last time I checked for CLG of about 2,500. But even with the gold deficit that they were in before, they've just had such a lock on these team fights with great play from Sword Art and Huni.
Mm-hmm. You know, the only thing I'm sad about, actually, is that Huni sold his tier before TSM were in such a secure position.
We never knew.
Because what if, you know, yes, you know, tier was turned into basically just another starting item, since it does give you that extra 5 bonus damage on hits for minions, in addition to all the mana that's going to give you for your combos for lane. But if he had kept it the entire time till this point, why not? You know, he definitely would have turned it into something, I feel like. Huni has the swag. Maybe we would have got to see it. And then that would last forever in the game logs for Ornn win rates with, you know, like an Archangels or a Muramana or something. Not going to be the case, though, you know, obviously, as he sold it, as you were looking for. Let's see if they can end it out, though, Pastry. Baron is back on the menu.
Alrighty, TSM going to have a stab at the second Baron of the game. It didn't get the last one. It was just barely went over to CLG. Solo, oh goodness, it's just the trap has been sprung. Smoothie, see you later. Speaker going to take him out. Huni going to lock up Solo in the front side of the map. And again, Gordrin can be damned. Lost, dominating, is going to take down the Crocodile. And that's going to be an easy Baron take. If TSM even won it, they're going to chase Griffin down instead, as Huni is out for blood today. TP's coming in. TSM looking to end the game right now.
Yes, they are. Oh,
oh goodness, Power of Evil. That was ill-advised. Double TP not quite working out, but lost over the side. Barely going to miss that next bullet. Has one more left. Oh, Pobelter with a very nice-looking flash. Does keep himself alive for a little bit longer, but TSM still streaming into the base alongside their supers. CLG going to have to hold on in a 3v4.
All right, that's going to be a tall task because there's plenty of regen with the Ocean Soul. TSM turn right back around to finish up the easier target here. Inhibitor tower number two falling down. Inhibitor number two. Looks like they want to wait for their man in the mid lane before they go for anything else here.
Yep, also think that at this point, given how much control they have of the map, they probably feel like Baron is maybe a bit easier to get than this mid inhib, so they'll take a stab at the mid lane first. Mm-hmm. We back in 4 seconds, no TP, but TSM looking to stay out on the map and probably reset the situation once again. Huni's ult's almost back off cooldown as well. I would be awfully careful if I was CLG.
Yeah, the thing is, they've only got 40 seconds left here on the Elder Dragon, and this is your only hope now for CLG. At this point, when you're facing Soul, plus you're facing this sort of lead from TSM, their hope is having a miraculous fight at one of these epic objectives towards the end game. Maybe you get a steal in there. Maybe you actually snowball and you get a bunch of kills as well. Griffin now trying to play a very difficult game, hovering around the back of this Baron, looking for an entrance. It's up to Huni and Sword Art, see if they can zone him off. Just send your ultimates, snare in Graves. He shouldn't be able to get close.
Yep, that's exactly what happens. Just an ulti over the wall for Griffin to try and grab that lucky steal, but Snake Eyes this time, his Elder Dragon is up and available. CLG know that this is basically the only thing they can do, trying to contest for this objective, but Griffin actually going to stop the team fight off Power of Evil in trouble. But here comes Huni with a big ulti, tying up the front side of the fight. Smoothie again, awfully low. Not really all that tanky, especially with the ulti not on, but Lost is going to continue peppering bullets in. People getting out of range. Last bullet is not quite going to attack Poe Belter, as the Scottercrab meets an untimely death. CLG still trying to get this Elder Dragon. They have to contest for this big objective.
And it might be doable. There's no Ornn ultimate, no Maokai ultimate, no Jhin ultimate now. That's what's really been destroying CLG. Their health bars are so low, though, already channeling some recalls. This could be teleport back in from solo. He's got flash.
The base is in trouble, which is why this is going to be trouble. Going to be so tricky. Smoothie, though, with the angle. Solo not going to join this fight by the looks of things, because this dragon is already so low. POV also around the side. Huni actually finding the jungle, so that's going to be Elder Dragon to TSM. Nice and easy. Solo TPing in way too late, as Griffin's about to get blasted by the Elder Dragon buff. Surely, there it is. Huni going to grab Griffin.
And it looks like TSM will silence CLG once again. So many objectives, Pastry. Elder Dragon even added on top of the soul, on top of the Baron for themselves. They weathered the early storm. Huni with his tears start just for the extra combos, wave clear. You can see that theoretically, maybe he's trying to AoE the wave, don't get close to the... He still got beat a lot in CS and outpressured heavily. Regardless, TSM, they play the weak side top, they play for the objectives, and that's gonna be a dub.
Yep. Nice and controlled here, and oh my goodness, look at these ultis just streaming into victory for TSM. And knock up from Huni, who just continues to find the angles. Lost gonna go godlike, and everyone's gonna explode. See you later, solo is the last ditch effort. Diving into the back of TSM will not merit anything but another death in the KDA column. And Turtle is back towards the Nexus. Dragon buffs are just blowing people up left, right, and center. And Turtle, you better dodge these. Supercharged up, last one. They're going to wait for it here, try and line it up, as the Sapling's also going to zone Turtle out of there, and TSM maybe looking to dive that next, but they'll finish it off instead in style as well. TSM will pick up the win against CLG.
And that is going to be quite a recovery here over the tournament from TSM. From opening with the loss to the struggle comeback win yesterday to now a very secure win in day number 3 versus CLG. TSM improving now in their group to 2-1. That makes you feel so much more confident, because all the teams are really worried about right now in the group stage of lock-in tournament is not getting last. If you don't get last, you at least still get to move on. You at least still get to play more games, and that's what people are looking for.
I will say, even though obviously CLG picked up a loss here, the question we asked at the start of this game was, you know, can we have cleaner looking early games for both of these teams? Because that has been an area they've seemed to struggle so far in this tournament. And I think, honestly, for both sides, through the first 20 minutes of play, you could see the ideas were much more cleaner. Both teams felt like they were way more on the same page. And CLG did have moments to potentially snowball that game that they could have arrested better control of. But I think overall, if you're looking at step one, which is like, hey, can you play your early games a little bit cleaner, please? I think both teams actually succeeded here.
Yeah, my first inkling that this was looking better and more decisive from TSM was when they don't fight that first Rift Herald versus the Renekton that's got a 25 CS lead, and they actually go bottom instead and trade for it. So, well done.
I also say, like, Huni for... he's had some struggles in lane, I feel like. People just like want to take difficult matchups and beat him up, but he's been hugely impactful in the games in more of a support role, which, if you look at the start of Huni's career, is not where we thought he would end.
Definitely true. I mean, he had a lot of good collapses. You know, playing weak side, coming in with the Ornn, with a lot of teleports, with flanks, he always was able to get somebody with the ultimate, use his Ornn ultimate in conjunction with Maokai Jhin range to be able to find so many of these kills, so many of these pickoffs for TSM in the early and mid stages where they are weaker and they're just looking for trading objectives while snagging some extra little gold here and there with some of those long range plays. And he did did that job perfectly. You don't expect him to win versus Renekton, regardless of what he starts.
Right, and with all that, we are going to be stepping away. But during the break, why don't you give youtube.com/LCS a follow so that you can keep up to date on all your favorite content. Do that, and we'll catch you here for an interview with Lost.
Don't let the comfort fool you. Don't let the attention to detail lead you to believe that a Honda is a delicate machine. You'd be wrong. Underneath every surface that carries a Honda badge, there has always been the capacity to amaze. From the core of everything we have ever built, all the way to the top of where you want to go. Rise to the challenge with the rugged performance of the Honda Pilot, Passport, and Ridgeline.
Welcome back, everyone, to the LCS. We are here after our game that we just witnessed where TSM came out on top. But I do have some news to share with you all. Mark, Alorum, Crumbs, are you ready?
Yes.
Hit me.
Let's hear it.
So CLG, after that game, have unfortunately been eliminated from play-ins. Letting that sink in for a moment. We have another divisive, you know, thing to digest here, Mark.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't the best showing for CLG. They did have to play with subs, and there were a number of these games where they had advantages, which I'm sure we'll cover in a little bit here, but they need to, you know, level up a little bit. That's what lock-in tournament is for. Find out where you're strong, find out where you're weak, and make improvements from there. And they will be playing next week still. It's just they won't be able to be in the knockout portion.
Well, and that's ultimately what a lot of what we're trying to drive from this lock-in tournament, right? What do you take away, especially when you're working with subs? And I think if we're looking at part of the early game of this Alorum, there were some things that maybe CLG can try and walk away with.
Right. So when we have seen Ornn versus Renekton a lot, and usually when you pick that matchup, even in the counterpick, you're going to be down, what, 20 CS, maybe a level, maybe some plates. And that's normal. And I don't know why. I think a lot of people have questions about it, but Huni built tier this game, and I cannot tell you why he did it other than just to have some more mana, or he's crying that TSM banned the Gnar away from him, although maybe some people are a little happy about that, as we've seen in the past, but no flame at all. Anyway, so
sure.
The Ornn this time had minus 40 CS, and he was, I believe, 1.1k gold down, which is an insane amount. Solo had a really good laning phase, or Huni had a really poor laning phase, depending on the way you look at it.
Little column A, little column B, maybe, you know.
So I think, but while the end of the game, he had some great roams. He used his timers really well, and he had good ults that impacted team fights really well. His lane phase was not great, and really, Solo should have done a lot more off his gigantic lead. I would have liked to see him push waves a little faster and be the first one to the team fight rather than letting Huni just go whenever he wanted.
Taking a bit more of the control in his hands, right? But I think as far as what we got doing down right now, we do have Dash standing on by with Lost for an interview.
I have swung into Dash's seat, and I have found Lost here from TSM after their victory. What's up, man? How have you been?
We've been okay. Our first two games were pretty rough, and our early games were pretty terrible. So good to have at least a little more of a stable game this game.
It did look pretty strong, even with the Baron kind of take steal coming in that they were able to sneak out. Did it feel pressured at that point? You were still pretty ahead.
No, for the most part, I think we had pretty good control of the game in mid-game, just with our comp and what we drafted for. So I wouldn't say we were, like, stressed out. We were pretty calm about it, and we knew what we were doing in mid-game. So I'm glad we got to pull out the win in the end.
Awesome. Enough about the game. Let's talk about you. How was off-season? How is now? How you been feeling during lock-in here as the team starts to come online?
Mm-hmm. I mean, off-season was, it's just like you don't do anything for so long, and then you go on season, and everything's full-on, 13-hour days, you're practicing, and you're having a lot of fun, just for the most part, playing League. So that transition's sometimes a little stressful at the start, but now I'm just having fun with it, and, you know, playing the game more is just, you know, practicing with the team as well. Just so much fun, you know.
Yeah, more fun, some new people around you. What's it been like playing with Sordar? That has to be awesome.
Yeah, he's a world finalist. He's pretty good at the game, and he's just a great person overall outside of the game as well. I'm having a really good time both practicing and playing with him in these matches, and hopefully we grow to become a better bot duo in the future, and you know, you guys can look out for that.
That's really awesome. You know, on that topic, there's so many new faces around. I got to ask you, with you and Spica kind of being TSM veterans here and the team, new members coming in around you, what's that feel like now? Do you have expectations of yourself to kind of align those members and get them ready to be on the TSM squad?
It's always like a new experience playing with, you know, your team, because with your old teams, you play 12 hours a day, 6 days a week, and you're like living in the same place for the whole year, you know? So it's always a new experience to, you know, get more familiarized with your new team. And we're kind of like in the stage where you just like get to know each other outside of the game, both inside and out.
Yeah.
And it's like more comfortable because me and Spica have been on TSM for like remaining from last year. And just like inviting the rest of the guys into our culture and, you know, just TSM as an org. It's been a good time. Everyone's like, there's no stubborn personality on our team. It's just been good vibes all around, you know.
That's really, really awesome, Lost. Thank you so much for joining me here, man. It's been so great to talk to you again.
Thank you very much.
All right, another win for TSM there. Fans can be happy as they move on here from week one of the lock-in tournament. But don't go anywhere. We still have games on the day. It is going to be Team Liquid versus Golden Guardians coming up next.
Decorative towel.
There was a mess. I wiped up a mess. Yeah, you...
Where is the box? Never mind, I found it.
When game day is a go, there's a Bud Light there.